Welcome. I'm Dr. Tom Dawson. Today I want us to talk a little bit about the myths and the wise tales that we've heard over the years and that affect our day-to-day lives, even if we don't believe them. Before I get started, I got to say, I love grandmothers. There is no one who loves your child more than grandma. And, you know, there's no one who's more likely to come over at the last minute and babysit for you than grandma. Having said that, some of the things that she's told us over the past years may not be that firmly based in science. The first is that fever burns brain cells. Fever does not burn brain cells. Really, fever is our friend. You know, how many times has a fever been the first thing that made the parents or even the doctor aware that your child was ill and perhaps required a little closer observation? So that's a gift that we have that, in my opinion. So it should be our friend. One of the other things that perpetrates the myth is that so many parents and even medical professionals will aggressively treat all fevers with Tylenol and Motrin. And anything that you're given Tylenol or Motrin every few hours for, you know, the underlying implication is that this must be evil if it requires, you know, this much treatment. The fact of the matter is we're given these things really just to make your child feel better. Well, that's part of it. We're probably doing it also to make the parent feel better and even to make the doctor feel better. Because even though I know fever doesn't burn brain cells, I had a grandmother too. And so it makes me feel a little bit better when the fever's down. In any event, low to mid-grade, you know, fevers are not dangerous at all, and they do not cause any problems. And the only reason to treat is to make your child feel better. I've been a pediatrician for over 30 years, and I have never seen any damage to a child caused by fever. Now, can severely high temperatures be a problem? And the answer there is yes. The reason is that our bodies are really sort of complicated and sensitive chemical reactors that really perform best within a fairly narrow temperature range. And so if a person is either too cold, you know, or too hot, they can get where those chemical reactions don't work as well, and some of the important bodily functions within us begin to break down. So if someone's been either out in way too much heat, or for whatever reason they get too hot, or if they're too cold, we're going to try to warm them up to get them back into a more normal range. If they're too hot, we'll try to cool them down to get them into a normal range. But these are generally not fever-related issues. So if your child has 103 or 104, that's a good reminder that we should be getting in contact with our doctor. But it is not a time that we need to worry that we're causing damage to our child's brain. So where does this myth come from? You know, to me, the obvious answer is that while their fever doesn't cause brain cells, some of the illnesses that cause fever can. So if your child's running fever because they have a bacterial meningitis or some infection like that, where you have bacteria, you know, causing an infection around your brain and spinal cord, well, certainly that type of infection can cause brain damage. And so I think in the past, clearly people didn't understand those issues as well, but they could tell that the child had fever. And so they assume that the fever what was actually causing the brain's damage, which in fact it was not. So to move on to the second and third most common myths that I hear, and I'm going to present them together because grandma so frequently uses them both in the same sentence. And that is, first off, make sure you put on your coat before you go outside so you don't catch your death of cold. And the second, when it's raining, make sure you put on your raincoat so that you don't get your head wet and catch cold. So let me tell you that cold weather and being wet, neither of those things cause you to catch a cold. The cold is passed by viruses, and it goes from person to person, primarily by touch. My best example of this are the Eskimos, who live in a remote place where it's cold and wet all the time, and they are cold and wet 90% of the time, and yet they almost never get sick. And the reason that they never get sick is it's so cold and remote where they live that they just don't have that many friends. And the friends that they do have, they can't touch them very easily because they're always wearing big coats and big gloves that keep them from having a minimal amount of person-to-person contact with their friends. And for that reason, they're a very healthy group of people. So illness, it turns out, at least passing colds especially, is really more about popularity. The more friends you have and the more people you touch, the more colds you're going to get. And if you don't believe me, go down to your local popular daycare center and you can see this fact in action. To speak about the issue of getting your head wet, well, that's obviously not a problem. What do we do when you call your doctor and you have 104 fever? The doctor says, we'll put your child in a tepid bath and sponge off their head and the neck. We wouldn't be having you sponge off their head and neck with water if that was just something that was going to make them catch a cold. So cold nor wet will make you catch a cold. So where does the myth come from? In my opinion, it has to do with cold weather and wet weather make us stay inside more. And when you stay inside, you're in contact with a lot more people, and it's much more easy for you to pass germs from one to another. Likewise, cold weather in and of itself is a nasal irritant and makes your nose run. You've been outside when it's cold, and all the next thing you know, your nose is running. So that irritation to your nose makes your nose run. And then you touch your nose with your hand, and then you touch your friend with that hand that has running nose on it. And that's how you pass germs from one person to the next a lot more easily than normal. So being inside does make you more likely to catch colds. Being outside in the cold and wet does not. So that's how it works. I don't want you calling grandma and being all snooty and saying, Dr. Dawson says that you're wrong. No, I want you to respect the fact that your grandmother loves you, to understand that some changes in this world are going to be more generational type changes, and that this is something that will slowly fade away with time. So love your grandmother for loving you. I hope this will help you understand colds a little bit better.